wish I knew when this mountain in my way is gonna move. Hope it's okay to tell the truth. Sometimes the doubt starts to win. Yeah, I'd be lying if I told you I was anything but weak. Right now my struggle's all I see. But I'm not giving in. My story will not end in defeat. 'Cause nothing can stop an unstoppable God. He's not afraid of impossible odds. This is the promise that I'm standing on. Nothing can stop an unstoppable God. The lie that says it can't be done. I know my war's already won, and I'm claiming victory, 'cause I know who's fighting for me. Nothing can stop an unstoppable God. He's not afraid of impossible odds. This is the promise that
got a purpose. So So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history.
Go down in history.
Has another blood bought faithful member of the family.
That's all I ever wanna be.
And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Cause I'm just a nobody,
nobody.
Trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Hardly think as you call me deeper.
Hello, everyone. My name is Glenn Travis, and this is my beautiful wife, Carrie. And the two of us are really excited you've made the decision to join us virtually today for our worship service. Carrie and I are members of the Boston Church of Christ and have been members for 30 years now. Wow. The Boston Church of Christ is a large church with a Sunday attendance of approximately 2,500 people meeting in 8 different locations on a typical Sunday. If you're visiting here with us, we are really glad you are. You know, I fully understand that in a group of this size, people watching today could be at vastly different places in their journey to understand and know God. It's good to ask ourselves sometimes simple questions like, what brought me here today to watch this service virtually? You know, there are a few things that define who we are as a church fellowship and what we are all about. We are going to simply name a few.
We have a truly diverse and multicultural membership.
We are deeply committed to the ministry of Jesus.
We believe that the Bible is the inspired word of God.
You know, we believe that the scriptures have tremendous relevance for our 21st century lives.
And we emphasize the need for one another relationships with deep friendships and have a strong sense of family, which I am so grateful for.
You know, we encourage one another to hold to the greatest commandments found in Matthew 22, looking at verses 36 through 40, which talk about love God with your whole heart, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as you would love yourself. You know, we are but two of many who have been radically changed by God's word, and I am continually called higher by my church family, brothers and sisters. You know, I have seen and experienced firsthand how the Bible has helped people to break down the walls that divide us, segregate us, and keep us from being a unified community. You know, I've seen folks overcome challenge after challenge during this crazy current pandemic situation that we're all facing. You know, Carrie's going to share just for a moment a little bit about her story to you at this time.
I just want to say that it has been an honor and a privilege to be a part of this amazing church. I was first invited over 30 years ago, which I can't believe, and I was so moved by the love and vulnerability that people have and the friendships that they had. First, their love for God and His Word, and then their love for one another. And I'm still so moved by that now. I'm glad that I've been able to stay connected via Zoom. I'm so grateful for Zoom with Bible discussions and women's groups. Just where we've been able to talk about what we're feeling, what we're thinking, and then encourage and inspire each other with scriptures and just what's helping us. I know it can be easy to get anxious or fearful, but being able to see people's faith and their trust in God, especially over the last couple of months, has really helped me to be at peace. Mm-hmm. There are so many of you all over this church that have helped me in my marriage, in my parenting. You've helped my children, and I am so, so grateful. I do not know what I would do without God and without all of you. So thank you and welcome this morning.
You know, as we continue our service today, let us consider this scripture that I'm about to read and what it is really trying to convey to us. In John chapter 10, verse 10, the Bible states, "A thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, but I have come so that they may have life, and I want them to have it in the fullest possible way." You know, God's heart and desire for each of us is to live a life in the fullest possible way. His way is truly the best way, honestly, the only way. Mm-hmm. Jesus later in the book of John stated, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." You know, when we wholeheartedly embrace what this means for our lives, how amazing it will be to hear the words from God Himself one day state to us, well done, my children, well done. Please pray with us as we continue our service. Father, we want to thank you for this time that we can be together. Obviously, we're together virtually, and we're grateful that we have the technology and the ability to do so. God, we want to give you, God, the honor that you deserve. We want to give you the praise, God, that you deserve. We are so thankful for your word. We're so thankful, God, for your church. We're so thankful that we can develop and have deep relationships with one another. We're so grateful, God, for your plan of salvation. We're thankful, God, that we can go to you with anything and everything that we're feeling, and just be able to surrender it, God, over to you. Our prayer, God, is that you will bless our service today. Be with each man, woman, and child that's with us virtually. I pray that all of us will walk away inspired and encouraged to really just grab hold of our relationship, God, with you. In Jesus, your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. Oh, Father, Spirit, and Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. Yes, how great is our God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Yeah. your love has saved us.
Lord, your love has saved us.
Your precious blood has bathed us.
Your precious blood has bathed us.
Oh, now your message takes us.
Now your message takes us.
All around the world.
All around the world.
Can't you hear them? Hear them singing.
The people there rejoicing. With one voice they are shouting. Singing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise is heard around the world.
Into all creation,
each and every nation.
Oh, we're sending your salvation,
sending your salvation
all around the world.
All around the world.
Can't you hear them?
Hear them singing.
Oh, hear them singing.
The people there rejoicing
with one voice. They are shouting, singing, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise is heard around the world. Against the demons fighting.
Against the demons fighting.
With the Holy Spirit guiding.
Holy Spirit guiding.
Oh, my family, we're united.
Family, we're united.
Oh, hear them singing.
The people there rejoicing.
So with one voice they are shouting, they're singing hallelujah,
hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah.
Praise is heard around the world.
Sing it again. Can't you
hear them?
Can't you hear them?
Hear them singing.
Oh, hear them singing.
The people there rejoicing.
So with one voice they are shouting, they're singing to me hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah,
hallelujah.
Praise is heard around the world. Can't you hear? Can't you hear them?
Hear them singing.
Oh, hear them singing. So with one voice they are shouting, they're singing hallelujah,
hallelujah,
hallelujah.
Praise is heard around the world.
Praise is heard around the world.
Praise is heard around the world.
Woo!
Good morning. My name is Mike Van Auken, and I get to be an elder and also an evangelist here in the Boston Church. God is always moving, and there's always good news around God. And so right now, we're going to bring you several segments that describe how God is moving powerfully in a wide variety of ways. In the first segment, we're going to share about our Walk for Hope. 2 weeks ago, the whole Boston Church participated in our annual Walk for Hope. It supports Hope Worldwide and a variety of area food banks. Money is still coming in. We have raised over $70,000 so far. You'll hear more about that in the video, but God has done amazing things. Then we'll introduce you to Nate Walters. Nate is one of our young professionals. He's currently away from military training, and God has moved in some incredibly faith-building ways in Nate's life. You'll hear all about that. Then you'll meet Dave and Erica. Dave and Erica are two of our missions ambassadors, members of the Boston Church that help us stay in touch with the mission field. Foreign missions has been part of the backbone of the Boston Church really since its inception. And Dave and Erica have some great news to bring us, both from Madrid, Spain, and from Kiev, the Ukraine. So please sit back and watch and be amazed at God and what he's doing in our world around us.
On May 17th, we participated in the Walk for Hope, raising money for the global efforts of Hope Worldwide and the local efforts of 10 different food banks and food pantries around the Boston area, helping them to provide for those who are food insecure in this area. One of those places that we donated to was the Merrimack Valley Food Bank right here in Lowell, Massachusetts. This was an opportunity for you to put your compassion into action, and you responded. It was inspiring to see men, women, and children leave their homes and walk and run 5Ks in their neighborhoods and communities. You were not only active physically, but you raised funds as well. And in fact, so far, you've raised over $72,000. You're history makers. That's more than we've ever raised in any single year for the Walk for Hope in the last 14 years. On behalf of the Boston Church of Christ and Hope Worldwide, Massachusetts, I want to say thank you. Thank you for partnering with us in this effort. Thank you for spreading the word to others so that they could help in this effort as well. And thank you for being so generous to help, to support, to meet the needs globally and meet the needs here within our community as well. Thank you for expressing your faith and love through action. Your small acts make a big impact. As disciples, we know that we have been so blessed by God. Let's continue to look for opportunities to be a blessing and a light in our communities. Let's go and let's bring hope to the world around us. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Good morning, church. My name is Nathan Walters. I'm part of the Young Professionals Ministry in Metro, and I have some good news to share today. So I have been in Arizona since February. I've been temporarily stationed out here for some military training, and my time out here has been incredibly encouraging. So when I got out here in February, I'm in a class of about 40 or so people. So when everyone got here, we were first meeting each other. Nobody really knew each other prior to coming here. Everybody's making new friends, getting to know the class, and I met this guy named Dalton, who I thought was really cool initially, like right off the bat. He seemed like a good guy. So we were hanging out a lot that first week. And then on Friday, we were talking about our weekend plans for our first weekend out here, because we have weekends off. We don't train on the weekends. So he mentioned he was going up to Tucson for a church service, and I had already been up in Tucson. So Tucson is the closest major city to this base. So that's where our church is. We have the Tucson Church of Christ meets in downtown Tucson. So he had mentioned that he was going up to Tucson to find a church. And I told him, like, hey, I already have a church up there that I'm going to. You should come with me. And he was like, I'm kind of like committed to this church that I just joined. So I was like, cool, man. Like, which one is it? What's the name of the church? And he didn't know. He like forgot or something. He just didn't really know the name of the church. So I texted him later that day, like, Tucson Church of Christ, is this the church you're looking at? You're looking to go to? And he was like, yeah, that's exactly the church that I was going to go to. So he became a disciple about a week before coming out here. So at that point in time, he had only been a disciple about 2 weeks. So I wasn't like too familiar with our church as a whole. Didn't really know where to find us, but it was just a really funny coincidence that the first guy that I met and liked and was hanging out with was a disciple and was going to was already going to go up to church in Tucson with us, to meet with us. While him and I went up to Tucson that first Sunday, got to know everybody there. It's a great ministry in Tucson. And before COVID got crazy, we were going up there every Sunday, and we were bringing lots of people from our class too. A lot of people from our class were interested in going to church and just getting reconnected with God. Most of them, some of them meeting God, starting a relationship with God for the first time. Every week we kind of brought up new people, different people. But there was one guy in particular that came every Sunday. His name was Josh. And Josh and Dalton actually knew each other prior to coming here. They went to college together. Josh was coming up every Sunday. And then eventually Dalton and I asked him, like, do you want to study the Bible? And he did. He was very interested in studying the Bible. So for about a month and a half, maybe 2 months, we studied the Bible together. And Josh eventually decided he wanted to become a disciple. He wanted to get baptized. So we baptized him 2 weeks ago in a lake near the base. It was amazing. It was amazing just to study the Bible with him and just go through the studies and get to know him better. And he's an incredible guy. He was incredibly fired up to become a disciple. So We've also had a weekly Bible talk that meets every Tuesday in my room, and 12 or so people come to that every week, and they love it. So it's been an incredibly encouraging, faith building time out here, and though I'm having a great time, I miss home. I miss everyone in Metro a ton. I can't wait to see all of you. I'll be home in about a month, hopefully. Well, the COVID thing will probably still be crazy, but maybe I'll see you guys outside of church. But I love you guys. I miss you, and I'll see you guys soon.
Hello, I'm David Seavey, and now it's time for some good news from the mission field. The Boston Church has been planting churches in Europe and helping to support them for almost 40 years. Each month, Erica Chalmers and I will try to help you get to know the people in those churches better. This time, we bring you to Madrid, Spain, and Kiev in the Ukraine. I'm excited to be able to take you to Madrid, the city and the place that I called home for over 5 years. The church is currently being led by Will and Kristen Lambert. I want to introduce you to Andrea, who is a university student studying far from her home. Although she had felt close to God since she was young, after reading the Bible on her own, she began to realize that just saying she believed wasn't enough, and she needed to start putting it into practice. When she got to Madrid, she met some people from the church. They invited her to study the Bible, and she realized what part of her relationship with God was missing. She got baptized on the first night of the quarantine in Madrid and has been living with a couple there ever since. We will now hear the two questions in Spanish and see Andrea's baptism.
Andrea, ¿tú crees que Jesús vino a este mundo, murió por tus pecados, resucitó y fue para que un día tú lo conozcas y puedas ser parte de la familia de Dios?
Sí, yo creo.
Amén.
Andrea, ¿cuál es tu buena confesión?
Que Jesús es el Señor y Salvador de mi vida.
Amén.
Yo te tengo de la nariz, uh-huh. Respira. Una, dos, tres.
Yes.
It's always great to see people make their decision to follow Christ. It doesn't matter what part of the world they're in or what language they're speaking, it's always inspiring. Now Erica is going to introduce us to a couple living in Kiev. Erica?
Thanks, Dave. Up next, we have a short segment from a couple in Kiev, Ukraine. Max and Britton, they lead the campus ministry in Kiev, which is one of the biggest campus ministries in Europe. And I got to spend some time with Britton this week, and I thought you guys would enjoy getting to know them as well. So sit back and enjoy the next 2 minutes or so of questions and answers with Max and Britton.
Hi, my name is Max. This is my wife, Britton. We live in Kiev, Ukraine.
And we were asked by Erica to answer a few questions for you guys. So the first question is, what is something that made you want to follow Jesus?
So I think it is the fact that Jesus has something to offer us, some goal, something bigger than us and bigger than everything we have on earth.
And I love about Jesus that he doesn't expect anything from us that he wouldn't do himself. So even though he's the prince and he's the creator, he still was humble enough to die for us, to humble himself, and it's an example we can always imitate. Second question is, what is something unique about your spouse or something you love?
So I really like that we can laugh together and have so much fun together and make jokes.
And I love that my husband is very confident, which I'm not, so that's really helpful. And even though he's younger than me, and people might ask him, oh, you know, how do you feel? He's like, am I even supposed to feel weird about that? Like the thought never even came into his mind. And it's just awesome to watch him talk to people and be so easygoing. And yeah, I love that about him. Third question, what is an interesting aspect of your city or country?
So I really like that in our country, you can grow mostly everything on our soil and then eat it. And it's really good usually. So yeah, this is what I like.
And I like that even though we live in Kiev, which is the capital, and it's a huge urban center, you can basically use the metro or the bus to get anywhere in like 40 minutes. So any disciple, any person is within your reach pretty much within half an hour. You can see your friends, and that's really cool. So that's it.
Yeah.
We're sending you lots of love and hugs from Ukraine.
I always enjoy hearing the stories from our brothers and sisters in Europe. The Heroes for Missions, however, aren't just in other countries. Some are members in our own congregations here in New England as well. One such hero is Karen Kolarik, a member of the Boston Church in the metro region. Karen, as some of you know, will be moving soon to live closer to her father in Arizona. Karen was an original board member of the European Mission Society. She was chosen because of her incredible heart for the work being done to spread biblical Christianity throughout Europe. She has taken trips to Europe at her own expense just to get to know the churches and encourage them. She has brought back amazing stories that have inspired us, and she brings those congregations closer to us in our minds and in our hearts in a very eloquent style. So Erica and I want to express our appreciation for the work that she has done. Thank you, Karen, for being the gold standard for what it means to be a true zealot for missionary work. We wish you all the best in your next chapter. Erica and I look forward to the next time that we can be together and share some good news from the mission field. Adios.
You are the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name. Didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Ryan Jambion. I am part of the Young Professionals Ministry in the metro region of the Boston Church, and I get the privilege of sharing my thoughts on contribution with you today. I had a quick verse that really challenged me this week when discussing it with the Young Professionals group that I wanted to share. It's in Luke 12, verses 10 through 12. It says this: "Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own?" You know, as a young professional, I've been out of college for several years now. I'm recently married. There's a lot of changes happening. Obviously, COVID has affected all of our lives. You know, it's very tempting for me to really feed into the message that is fed to young professionals getting out of college of, you know, really conquer the business world and to establish yourself financially and to make as much money as possible as fast as possible. And that can be very challenging when I look at the scriptures of what God is telling me what to do with my wealth and how I should be trusting Him with my wealth and being generous. And oftentimes the thought comes into my head of, man, what could I do with this money that I'm giving away? And in reality, God is telling me that if I don't learn to be trustworthy in what I have now, it's going to be very difficult for me to be trustworthy in what I have down the road and the more that I have down the road. It can be very easy for me to think, oh, well, later on I'll learn to obey and to really be sacrificial when I have more. And this scripture is clearly telling us that that's not the case at all. That now is the time for me to obey God and to be sacrificial because I won't do it later on. It's only going to get harder for me. And the other thing that I'd like to point out is in verse 11, it says, you know, Jesus defines worldly wealth differently than true riches. And he makes a clear distinction there. And what he's telling me is that if I don't learn to handle my wealth in a godly way, I will miss out on being given true riches that God provides when I am sacrificial and when I learn to be obedient with my wealth. So I want to make it a goal to really strive for true riches instead of being caught up in chasing after wealth that will be here today and gone tomorrow. If you are planning on giving, the best way to give right now is online. Let's pray for contribution. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you so much that we can still connect with one another through technology, Lord. I just ask that you would bless this contribution, that you would use it to glorify your name, to help many people, to further your kingdom, Father, and to really be a blessing to others, Father. I pray that we would trust you during the midst of uncertain times, and we continue to be sacrificial and generous to your work. We love you, God, and it's in Christ's name we pray.
Good morning. I want to welcome you online here to the Boston Church of Christ. We are the metro region, and I am so grateful that you've decided to tune in and worship with us this morning. Typically, we meet at a building in Framingham, Massachusetts at 214 Concord Street, but just like everybody else, we've gone online. We've gone virtual the last couple months. And last week, we actually kicked off a sermon series titled Prayer Dares. These are prayers that we find in the Bible that if you pray them, they are life-changing prayers. And they're prayers that you pray at your own risk, because if you do pray them, things are going to happen. Your life, your heart, your family, things are going to change. These are big, bold prayers. And that's what we're actually talking about this morning. The title this morning is titled, Make Me Bold. That's our prayer dare this morning. You know, nothing great, nothing truly great in life has ever happened without boldness. And this is a daring prayer because it involves action. Praying to God to make me bold is not a passive prayer. It's not something that you can just kind of pray on your couch and sit there and you have to wait and watch and you can't do anything about it. Praying make me bold, it involves risk. It involves adventure. It involves action. It's not something you just pray under your covers at night and then safely fall to sleep. If you pray this prayer, it's a call to action. We actually get this prayer from a prayer that the disciples prayed in the book of Acts. And in Acts chapter 4, if you want to turn with me there or on your phones or in your Bible, and the words will pop up on the screen as well, so you can read them any of those ways. But in verse 23 is where we'll begin. And if you read the beginning of the chapter, we see that Peter and John, they had just been arrested for boldly preaching the gospel out in the public. And they were taken to jail. Their lives were threatened. They were put on trial. Eventually, they were released because they hadn't committed a crime. But after they were released, they went back to tell the other Christians what had happened. And in verse 23, we pick it up there. It says, on their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. The Christians, you know, after they heard from Peter and John what was going on and the environment, the culture, the people were actively trying to prevent them from sharing about Jesus and spreading the gospel, they realized what was going on. But they knew the importance of their mission. They knew they couldn't be stopped from sharing about Jesus. And so they prayed to be bold. This is a powerful prayer. Right? And it's inspiring to see the Christians and throughout the book of Acts and the boldness that they had. But why should we pray this today? Why am I daring you to pray this prayer? And so today, the first reason that I dare you to pray this prayer is because it is part of your spiritual nature. If you want to turn to 2 Timothy chapter 1, in verse 7, Paul's writing to Timothy, and he tells him, for the Spirit of God does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. And when we are baptized, we are reborn into a new life filled with God's Holy Spirit. And Paul reminds Timothy here that his spiritual nature, the spirit that lives inside of him, is not timid, it's not fearful, but it's bold, it's powerful. If you have been born of the Spirit of God, this is now part of your nature. You may not always feel bold, you may not always act bold, but it is who you are. It is who God created you to be. Now, this week, a lot of the outdoor parks and businesses have been able to open up. And so we went, Jenna and Westbrook and I, as a family, to the Minden Zoo. And our son, Westbrook, who's 2 years old, he loved the zoo. He loved the animals. He walked around saying, I'm a lion, roar. And he was so excited to be there and to see the animals. But as we were at the zoo, I was reminded of a scene from a movie called Madagascar. This is an animated film about animals who are in a zoo in New York City. And the animals, they love being in the zoo. People come to see them every day and take pictures with them. They're well taken care of. It's a comfortable place to be as an animal. But there's a group of penguins who are discontent. And they start to think and talk about, hey, I don't know that this is where we are supposed to be. I have a feeling inside that there's something more out there than the zoo. And so the penguins, they come up with a plan to dig their way to Antarctica. And before they do, they actually end up talking to Marty the zebra. And the penguins tell the zebra, hey, do you ever see penguins running around New York City? Of course not. We don't belong here. It's just not natural. We are going to the wild where we belong. And you see Marty, the zebra, as he listens to them, he begins to get inspired and curious. And he asks, and he says before they leave, he says, you can actually go there? Before that moment for Marty, the wild, living outside in the wild, in the jungles, in the Sahara, this was just a fantasy. It was not a reality for him. But he realizes, he begins to realize that being in the zoo is not where he belongs. It's not part of his nature to live in a zoo. He's meant to be in the wild. And so he begins to make plans to go out into the wild. And he tells the other animals in the zoo, he's so excited. But when he tells them his plan, none of the other animals want to go with him. For most of them, the safe, easy, comfortable, well-fed life at the zoo, it was great. They had no reason to go and mix that up or mess that up. And they asked him, why? Why would you want to go out into the wild? Look at what we have right here at the zoo. The wild, that's a scary and dangerous place. That's not comfortable. It requires effort and hard work. You guys can go and watch the rest of the movie to find out what happens. But we see the zebra longing for something more, and the rest of the animals, they're just comfortable where they're at. But I think this is a really great picture of where we can be at in our faith as Christians a lot of times. There's a great temptation for us to have zoo animal faith. We're happy where things are and how they're going. It's easy. It's comfortable. There's no danger. There's no risk. There's no ridicule or persecution. There's no sacrifice necessary. And ultimately, there's no faith that's needed to live that life. Once you've lived in the zoo, it's hard to want to go back out to the wild. But as disciples, this is not who we are. This is not where we belong. We are wild animals created to live bold and courageous lives, to go out into a dangerous world and to bring healing, to take risk for the sake of spreading the gospel, to live a life of sacrifice for the sake of others. We are created for something more. We are meant for the wild. Hebrews 10 and verse 39, it says that we are not those who shrink back. We are those who live boldly by faith. The message throughout the entire Bible is for God's people to go. He created us to be action figures and not bobbleheads. And when we stand before God on the day of judgment, He won't say, well thought or well said or well planned. The only thing He'll say is, well done. God has a grand vision for His people and His kingdom in this world. He has a grand vision for you. In Matthew 5, Jesus, in the Sermon on the Mount, He says that His people, they're a city on a hill. They're a light for all of the world to see. And Jesus, as He preaches, He's just repeating the vision that God pronounced for His people in Isaiah. When Isaiah prophesied in chapter 49 and said, it is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring my salvation to the ends of the earth. God says, hey, I'm not about some small, rinky-dink, minimal impact plans. My vision is for my people to change the world. And we today are part of that vision. We are continuing to act out and bring that vision to fulfillment. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus tells his disciples, hey, after I leave and go back into heaven, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and then in Judea and Samaria, and then to the ends of the earth, you are going to go and tell people about me. And I think about the latest Avengers movie and Fat Thor. If you've watched it, I'm sure you're laughing as you picture Thor right now in his fat suit and long hair, and he just looks disgusting. He's out of shape, and he's on the couch, and he's got, you know, soda cans all over the place playing video games, and that's not who you picture Thor to be. But at some point, he gets discouraged, and he gives up on the battle, and he goes, and he just kind of hides out. And again, he gets fat and out of shape, and he's no longer living the life that he was called to live. He was comfortable. Things were easy. And he acted like he was enjoying this life. Man, the other life was hard. It was dangerous. It was risky. And he had given that up. But that's not who he was meant to be. He, Thor, the God of Thunder, was meant to go and save the world. He had lost sight of his vision and his inspiration and who he was meant to be. You know, I'm inspired today by real life Avengers, like the Peach family. Jonathan Peach, who's one of our young professionals in our ministry here, he and his family, his two parents, have decided to pack up and move in August to go to Budapest. To go and be part of a team of people who want to go and spread the message of Jesus to the people of Budapest and to help build the church in Budapest. And what's really cool is, what's extra inspiring is, when you look at this family and their ages, you have the parents, an older couple, and then you have their son, this younger man, but their spirit is the same age. All of them are zealous for God's kingdom. You don't grow old by adding years to your life. You grow old by losing your passion. You can be 25 years of age, but being old and decrepit in your spirit. There is no stage of life where we should not be zealous for God's kingdom. You look at Caleb, he says, I'm 80 years old, but I still have the same life inside of me. And today, it doesn't matter how old you are or where you're at, what stage of life, you can still be filled with boldness and the life of the Spirit that God puts inside of us. I don't think that means that everyone needs to move to another country to spread the gospel, but I do know it means that everyone needs to be engaged in the battle wherever you're at, in living boldly, living courageously. I want to challenge you not to cage your spirit. Not to allow yourself to have a zoo animal faith, but to realize what's out there and to know who your true nature is. How long will you put off what you're capable of doing just to continue to be comfortable? We need to step out. We need to go explore. God is calling you into action. He's calling you into the wild. This is your spiritual nature. And so if this is our spiritual nature, then you might ask, well, then why do we need to pray for boldness? If it's already part of who we are, why do we have to pray for it and ask for it? Well, that's the second point today, is that it's because it's not part of your sinful nature. When Paul writes to Timothy and he reminds him that the Spirit of God is not timid, that is because Timothy was tempted to be timid. There is a reason that Paul writes to him and has to remind him. There's a reason that Paul himself asked for the Christians in Ephesus to pray for him to be bold, because he was tempted to be timid. Why does God in the Old Testament remind Joshua over and over again to be strong and courageous? Because in his sinful nature, he was weak and fearful. In fact, the most repeated command in the entire Bible is, do not be afraid. Why is that? Why does God feel like necessary to remind us and to command us so many times to not be afraid? It's because in our sinful nature, we are afraid. We're timid. We're weak. Biblical heroes throughout the Bible, God has to remind them to be bold. Our sinful nature is cowardly. Science tells us that we're actually only born with two fears in life, and that is falling and loud noises. And the rest of the fears that we have, we actually pick up as we go along, and we do a great job of picking them up. Filled with fear. So many people live their lives filled with worry and anxiety and fear. You know, I am certainly not bold by nature. I think, you know, as I was growing up, I was confident in a lot of areas of my life. But in particular, when it came to talking to people, initiating conversation, whether it be a teacher or a coach or even girls, I was a straight up wimp. I was so nervous and afraid to initiate conversation. Even now, it's hard for me at times to initiate and to speak up and to share what I'm feeling or to start a conversation. But that's me in my sinful nature. It's not who I am in my spiritual nature. And those two, they're always battling. Our spiritual nature, our sinful nature, they're always at battle with one another. And that's why we need to pray. I was praying to be bold this past week. And I had an opportunity. I was actually driving away from our church building, and just down the street is Nevins Hall, this auditorium space. And there was a guy on the corner at the stoplight. He had a suit on. It was Sunday, actually, and he had a Bible in his hand. He was kind of pacing back and forth and saying some words and speaking out to the sky. And so I was at the stoplight, and I kept going, but I noticed him. And then as I was going, I thought, man, I should go and talk to that guy. I should figure out what he's doing and what he's out here trying to accomplish and why he's doing this. And so I drove along and I was debating whether I should or not. And then I decided to stop and turn around. And I did. And I went back and I parked and I went out and I talked to him and initiated a conversation. I asked him, hey, what are you doing? And it turns out he didn't speak much English. He was speaking in Spanish. And so we had a tough time communicating. And I tried my best that I could. But eventually I did go and I gave him an invitation. Invitation to come out to church, and hopefully he'll show up at the building one day when we're meeting together again. But there was an opportunity to be timid or to be bold, and I saw it, and I'd been praying it, and I asked God for help, and I went and acted, and I decided to be bold in that moment. There are many, many moments like that we have where we can be timid or we can be bold, and we need to pray that God would help us to be bold. Boldness is not an absence of fear. Boldness is overcoming fear. And we do this, we will do this through prayer and the power of God's Spirit that lives inside of us. When we remember Jesus' promise in Matthew 28 that He's always with us and that we can ask Him for whatever we need, that He'll be there and He'll provide it for us. The final reason that we need to pray to be bold is because there's a world that needs to be shaken. If we go back to Acts chapter 4, and in verse 31, the end of the passage that we read, it says, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. After they prayed, it says, the earth shook. And then the disciples, they went and shook up the world with the gospel. Later on in the book of Acts, in chapter 17, the Jews are upset because they're telling the crowds that the Christians have turned the world upside down. But the world needed to be turned upside down. Another result of our sinful nature is that the world is a messed up place. There's all kinds of evil and darkness. And our sinful natures have caused that. The world is spiritually dead. And so now it needs to be shaken. And we are called as disciples of Jesus to go bring light into the dark world, to impact the world and eternities with the gospel. Today, the Christian faith is more and more ridiculed, considered outdated, inferior even to the standards and the morality of the world. And society is drifting further and further away from the morality of God. Marriage is no longer a lifetime commitment. Divorce is common and usual and at times even encouraged. Abuse, sex trafficking, all kinds of sexual activity, while it may be hidden, it exists all around us. Greed and selfishness have led to crippling wealth disparity across the entire world. Homelessness and extreme poverty. Wars, divisions, these things are normal. And to most people, they're just a necessary part of life. During COVID right now, we see so clearly the loneliness and the lack of fulfillment from life as abuse and suicide skyrocket as people are forced to live inside their homes. They can't escape. You know, they have to live with people and their families, and or they're not able to go out and party and run around and be with their friends. And man, the lack of true relationship and the depth of relationship, it shows itself. What dominates social media right now is racism and police brutality. Even today as I'm speaking, there are protests going on all around the United States. Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, or any number of countless racial violence and prejudice. They're happening. They're going on right now. It's a divided place. And people, there's hate. There's bitterness. The world is a broken and messed up place. And so why pray to be bold? Because the world needs it. The world needs people. It needs disciples to go and to shake it up. And I'm not talking about rallies and protests. I'm talking about shaking up the world with the love and the truth of the gospel. The world needs people to speak out against sin and call people to righteousness. The world needs people to love those who don't deserve it. The world needs people to give to those in need. It needs people to provide hope and help and opportunity and relationship. You know, I think about, why did I become a minister at the age of 22 after graduating from Harvard with a world full of opportunities in front of me? It's because I realized that the world needs to be shaken. I needed to be bold. There was eternal work that needed to be done. Lives, souls that needed to be saved. And what's so cool, when you decide to be bold, I think what makes this even more powerful when one person decides to be bold is that you inspire others to be bold. That we see a progression in the book of Acts, a chain of events actually that starts with John and Peter in Acts chapter 4. You know, after they get arrested for boldly sharing their faith, they go back and tell the disciples what happened, and the disciples are emboldened and they're inspired, and they pray and ask God to make them bold. In Acts chapter 5, following the example of John and Peter, all of the apostles then are together publicly preaching. They get arrested for sharing their faith. In Acts chapter 7, one of the disciples, Stephen, he's inspired to go and be an example. He's inspired by the example of others to go and preach boldly the truth to an angry mob of Jews who end up stoning him to death. And that begins an intense persecution of the disciples that sends them out, scatters them from Jerusalem. But they still are inspired by the boldness of Stephen. And it says they shared their faith wherever they went. Philip is inspired by Stephen And he goes and brings the gospel to Samaria. And then eventually it reaches Ethiopia. The inspiration of the disciples, it even gets to the point in Acts chapter 11 where a few random disciples, we don't even know their names, but they decide to go and share the gospel with the Gentiles. And they say, let's just be bold. Let's just go share the gospel with everybody. Boldness inspires boldness. If you decide to be bold, you'll inspire others to be bold. One of our young professionals, Richard Das, who's from India, he's inspired by boldness. There were many years ago, there was a couple, the Blaus from Boston, who decided to take one suitcase and go on a mission team to go plant the church and spread the gospel in Bombay, India. And from them, the church grew, more disciples were inspired, more churches were planted throughout India, and eventually the message reached Twitchy, India, which is where Richard is from. And Richard heard the gospel and became a disciple because of the boldness that came from the Blaus and the mission team to India. And Richard today is inspired to be bold himself. He's at MathWorks spreading the gospel at his job and out in the streets. Richard's studying the Bible with people, trying to help them to know Jesus. And he's even inspired potentially one day to go back to India and continue the work of the gospel that was started by the boldness of the mission team that went there. Boldness inspires boldness. And boldness also loves company. They say misery loves company. Well, boldness loves company. As you pray this prayer, God, make me bold, and then go out to put it into action, there will be obstacles. There will be persecutions. You will, fear will start to creep in. Failure will come. Discouragement, peer pressure, all of these things, they're guaranteed to come. And when they come, you'll want to shrink back. You'll feel like being timid again. But that's when we need to rely on each other. We have these relationships. God set up the church and the relationships we have with our brothers and sisters to encourage and to inspire, to build up and to spur on. You're at the dinner table lately as we sit down, my two-year-old son, he's been inspired lately to feed himself. You know, usually we'll take the spoon or the fork and give him his food for dinner, but he's been wanting to do it by himself lately. And so I'll be trying to feed him and he'll say, do it self. And sometimes we'll let him do it by himself and he's not very efficient at it. He spills a lot. He can't get all that he wants to on the spoon. He's doing an all right job, but we have to realize if we want the world to be shaken, we can't do it self. We need each other and we need to work together. You know, I always push myself harder and go further when I work out with a partner or with a team. You will always be more bold when you are with others. And this is more exciting anyway when you get to go and do it and experience it with other people. You'll enjoy it more. You'll have more fun than you would if you try to do it by yourself. The world needs us to be bold. And it needs us to be bold together. Psalm 138 and verse 3, the psalmist says, God, when I called, you answered me. You made me bold. When you pray this prayer, make me bold, God will answer it. It's a prayer he would love to answer. He wants you to pray it. He desires to make you bold because that is who his spirit is. But when you pray it, like I said, pray at your own risk, because if you pray it, you better be ready to act. This prayer is not a magic trick. You don't just sit there and pray it and abracadabra, it happens. It involves effort. It involves us going to put it into action. You know, this prayer is more like making whipped cream. When you put cream and sugar together in the bowl, you don't just sit there and watch it become whipped cream. You got to go get a whisk. You got to whip it up. You got to put some effort into it before it actually becomes whipped cream. This prayer is dangerous because it requires that you go put it into action. You have to go and do something about it for it to be answered. And so what does it mean for you to be bold right now? Maybe for you, make me bold means you got to decide to become a Christian. You got to decide to get baptized. You've been studying the Bible, trying to decide, you know, do I really want to surrender my life and follow Jesus and live for righteousness and not for myself any longer? Maybe for you, that means going to serve someone or a group of people in need. And you need to gather up some resources and some others to go and to do that and have impact on your community around you. Maybe it simply means that you need to be bold and reach out and share your faith. You need to go invite people to church. You need to sit down with somebody. Say, hey, I would love to tell you about Jesus or what it means, what it looks like to be a disciple of Jesus. Maybe it means that you need to live very differently than you're living right now. Maybe you need to shake things up and to live differently than you are. I don't know what that means. Maybe it means you need to start something. Maybe it means you need to create something. Maybe it means you need to cut something out. I don't know. I don't know what it means for you. Maybe it means you need to take a risk. Maybe it means, actually, I believe it absolutely, in every case, means that we need to give up the easy, comfortable, safe life and journey out into the wild. It is where you belong. And so let's pray together. Let's decide to take the dare and to pray, God, make me bold. And then let's be ready for action. Amen.
Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for your sacrifice and letting your son Jesus die on the cross for us. God, I know I can never repay that sacrifice. And I know, especially during this time of pandemic, it's easy for me to be anxious and worried about the things I can't control instead of pondering how mighty and great you are. I know that before the beginning of time, you chose me. And I know before I was born, you planned each and every one of my days. And God, as we take the bread that symbolizes his broken body and the juice that symbolizes his blood on the cross, God, help me to seek you for who you are and not just for what you provide. God, I thank you and I praise you. In the name of your son Jesus that I pray. Amen.
Well, thanks again for being with us today. I hope you've enjoyed the service. If you're not familiar with the Boston Church, I want to make sure that you know that we have neighborhood groups all over the Boston area. Of course, we're not meeting in person right now, but if you're interested in meeting disciples of Jesus, men and women who can become great friends and spiritual supports that live near you, we can connect you with a small group that lives nearby. And so please reach out and connect with us here on Facebook or YouTube, and let's make sure that we get you connected in that way. Thanks very much for being with us. I hope you have a great day and a really great week. Thanks again.